I want to ask one more question of any one of the panelists who wants to comment. Bringing the topic back to one of the topics that was raised during the introduction to this session, which is that issues of water do not occur in isolation. The issues that we're talking about in terms of water are really linked to issues of food, issues of energy, issues of security, and so on. And so I'm wondering if a couple of the panelists want to comment on how they see these linkages occurring specifically within the context of California and specifically within the context of both the drought and El Nino conditions that we've seen over the last few years. And maybe we'll go back to Chris first, since it's been a very long time since he's had a chance to say something.
You know, we often write about water, energy, climate, food nexus, and there's no question that we're looking at a series of densely interconnected linkages between water that's available for urban areas, water that's available for manufacturing, water that's available for agriculture. And of course, we haven't spoken very much about the dominance of California's water demands that are imposed by agriculture and how being more efficient with agriculture can release a very large fraction of the total water demands for other users. And of course, California agriculture has been very successful in doing better and better. I think that we often don't think about the important connections between water and human health issues that Anna and Isha both raise. And I think the other set of connections that I encourage people to think about as we consider other topics this evening is what I think of as social and economic teleconnections. In climate science, we often talk about climate teleconnections, where an El Nino event in the eastern Pacific causes decrease in corn yields in eastern Africa. But what we really see are connections where changes in the amount of lettuce that can be grown in California impacts food prices in Texas, which has implications for how many people are moving back and forth across the border with Mexico. And so in a world that's as densely populated and as densely interconnected as ours is, we need to recognize that every issue has the potential to spiral into a global set of teleconnections.
Thanks. Other thoughts?
I think that was the only thing I would add, and I think often gets lost sometimes in the nexus conversation and even in the human health conversation, is what we're seeing with emerging infectious disease. And just bringing it up because Zika is, I know, is been in the headlines, and as a pregnant woman, I think about that a lot as well. I mean, who travels a lot. But the reason why, in part, we're seeing diseases like Zika emerge in the southern United States, have the potential to emerge, things like chikungunya, is because we are seeing this change in climate. And when you do think about a lot of these being mosquito-borne illnesses, you need a habitat in which mosquitoes can live. That also is talking about a lot of the interventions are about kind of rainwater collection and standing water. And so I think I would just argue that part of what we need to be thinking about in terms of these connections is that we need to get a handle on things sooner rather than later, because the complexity actually is only spiraling out of control. And it is going to be a blessing for us to be thinking about water and human health just from water quality standpoint, because otherwise we're going to start to have to be dealing with diseases that we fortunately have not had to deal with because of our climate, and our southern colleagues have, that will be emerging. So just to make sure that we talk about human health, we're also thinking about kind of emerging infectious disease, and not just the very important, but more actually in many ways mundane issues of clean water, which we should be solving, as you've said, have solved already within California.